I want to get down on my knees and pray, and I want you to stand to your feet because you know what? You need prayer. You're a mess. I need prayer too. Come on, stand to your feet and let's go before the Lord. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus, giving you all the praise, all the glory, and all the honor. We thank you, Father, we have not come into the house, nor will we ever, to hear from a man or a woman. We haven't come to hear from a tall man or short man. We haven't come to hear from a white man or black man or brown man. We haven't come to hear from a young man or an old man. We have come to hear from the teacher of the church, who is the Holy Spirit. Welcome, Holy Spirit. Touch us, heal us, strengthen us, encourage us, guide us, guard us, direct us, and motivate us to be all that you would have us to be, Father. All that the Son paid the price for us to be, and all that the Holy Spirit has empowered us to be. And God will give you all the praise, all the glory, and all the honor. Now, Lord, as you bless us, we're grateful, but Lord, we remember all the other churches that are out there too. They're preaching the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ all across the Inland Empire as well as around the planet, and we would ask that you bless our brothers and sisters wherever they're at. If they're preaching the gospel, we love them and we're in agreement with them. And we ask that you'd bless them, Father, as you would bless us. We'll give you the praise, glory, and the honor as the word of God today becomes alive in our hearts. In Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement with a great big shout. We say amen. Amen. I just want to share something as you take your seat. Now, I want you to listen to what I'm going to say to you. A lot of times people don't understand what's before them. We come into the church, we hear somebody preach, we say, good message, doesn't mean much, you know, we greet them at the back door, all that kind of stuff. It's really not what should happen. This is the handbook, the manual on how to live life. Now listen to what I'm going to say to you. You want to prosper? This will tell you how to prosper. You want to get blessed? This will tell you how to get blessed. You want to have a great marriage? This is how you can have a great marriage. You want to raise your children the right way so they grow strong? Right here. Tells you every bit about it. This is the word of God. It refers to itself. Let me say it again. It refers to itself as the hidden mysteries of God. And these hidden mysteries of God for thousands of years have proved themselves to be truth and real. And if you want to be successful in every area of your life, all you have to do is apply the principles of the hidden mysteries of God. Now, when I make the statement, hidden mysteries of God, listen closely. It's hidden because it's hard to find, and mystery because it's hard to figure out. Hard to find, hard to figure out. When you find it, figure it out, and apply it in your life, it changes the world that you live in. And that's what this is really all about. Today, as we go into the Word of God, we're going back to Hebrews, the 11th chapter, before the marriage series. Pastor Dan's going to start off with the marriage series next week. But in between these different series, we're always going to cover line upon line, precept upon precept, the Word of God. We're in Hebrews, the 11th chapter. And we're happening to be in a place that is so incredibly dynamic that I'm telling you today, when you leave this place, you will say, oh my goodness, what an amazing truth I heard today from the Holy Spirit. Now I'm going to take you there because first of all, I'm going to give you a title of the message. You're making notes. This is called Characteristics That Please God. And sometimes, I don't know about you, but I want to be somebody who's pleasing to God. If I got one life to live, I know that if I please God, I'm going to get blessed. Let me say it again. If I please God, I know I'm going to get blessed. One more time. If I please God, I know I'm going to get blessed. Therefore, I want to please God, and I can't always please God in my own thinking. I've got to kick my thinking out and start thinking like He thinks and start seeing like He sees. And sometimes we need to see things that are in the natural and we need to see the spiritual side of them. One more time. Sometimes we need to see things that are in the natural and we need to see the spiritual side of them, the spiritual truth that's being talked about. And oftentimes we'll look at something in the natural and understand it, but we won't understand the spiritual side of it. Case in point, let's go to Hebrews, the 11th chapter, verse number 23. I'm going to read through some verses here, just a few verses. Is that okay? Can you stay with me as I read through the verses? And guess what we'll do? And then I'm going to come back to the verses and I'm going to explain to you, because in this there's spiritual insight, the hidden mysteries of God that are ready to change, that are ready to change, that are ready to change, that are ready to change your life and my life. Are you following me? First of all, let's take a look at this, looking at the spiritual side of things. Verse number 23, back in November, Pastor Dan did a great job of bringing us Hebrews 11, chapter verse 23. And it says this in verse number 23, it says, by faith, Moses, when he was born, was hidden 3 months by his parents because they saw that he was a beautiful child and they were not afraid of the king's command. Can I just say something? Here you see something that's brilliant. They didn't look at the nose, they didn't look at the eyes, the ears, the hair, the size of the kid. Can I tell you something? He's probably like any other baby. You know, he cried, he groaned, he was hungry, needed to be changed, got a rash, pooped his pants, just like you and me. Not now, but then. And we find that he's probably a normal child, but the parents, listen to me, saw something spiritual about him. Oftentimes, we don't see the spiritual in things, and that's why we miss what God has for us. And that's why it's called the hidden mysteries of God. And that's why we need to find them, figure them out, and apply them. They saw that this child had special things. Oftentimes, we just look at the natural eye and never look at the spiritual looking. Very important for us. Let me read the next couple of verses, then I'm going to come back and explain the verses, then I'm going to share with you three words out of these verses that are absolutely life-changing, that are, if you will, the nuggets, the gold, the hidden mysteries of God that all of us are here to see that'll change our life. Are you with me? Okay. Are you listening? I'm going to demand from you something. I'm going to demand you listen. And the reason for that is because I love you enough, respect you enough to tell you this is life-changing. And you don't want to daydream and think about some stupid stuff when you could get the wealth of God for your future. Because here's why. Here's why. Let's be honest. You want to be blessed. You don't want to be cursed. And I'm going to show you how to get blessed today, not cursed. You don't want to live your life out at the end of your life saying, gosh, God let me down. Some people got blessed. I saw those Christians. They were fine, but I didn't get it. I've been miserable, I've been down, out, punched around. This has been a miserable life. Let me tell you something, there's so many people out there that are like that, and that call themselves Christians that are miserable. You don't have to be that way. All you have to do is learn, listen to what you're gonna say, and apply, and watch it change your entire world. So you can sit there brain dead today and look at me and not even get anything, or you can concentrate for the next few minutes and I'll let you go. Is that okay? Then the Holy Spirit will deal with you after that. Verse number 24. In verse 24, it says this. By faith, Moses, when he came of age, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. Verse 25. Choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the passing pleasures of sin. Verse 26. Esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures of Egypt, for he looked to the reward. Verse number 27. By faith, he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him. He endured as seeing, notice the capital H on the word him, Jesus, seeing him who is invisible. Ooh, lot, these verses, power packed. But the three words that we can get from Revelation is found starting verse number 24. In fact, let me pop it up on the overhead, verse 24, and let's talk about it just for a moment. This is Moses. Obviously, he's pleasing to God. He's in Hebrews, the 11th chapter. He's a hero. Why is it being told about Moses? Just so that we could say, wow, let's make a Sunday school teaching out of it? Isn't Moses wonderful? Wasn't he great? Listen, it's being told so that you and I could listen, understand the principles, and apply them in our lives. That's why this story is here. That's why it's called Revelation. It becomes alive on the inside of us and we apply. This is not a Sunday school story about how great Moses is. Was he great? Yes. But it's there as an example for you and I to learn from. Now in verse number 24 is our first word that is really fascinating. Remember, there's going to be three words that are life-changing that we could see by revelation in these outstanding examples found in these verses. Verse 24, it says, by faith Moses, when he came of age, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. Oh my goodness. Refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. That's like insane. Why wouldn't he want to be the son of Pharaoh's daughter? Did you know they were the richest people in that whole area? They had all the gold they could possibly want. They had all the silver they could possibly want. They had the armies. They were powerful. They were builders. They were knew what they were doing. They were so, I mean, who wouldn't want to be part of that family? And all of a sudden, here is a guy named Moses, and he's making a statement. And his statement is, I do not want to identify with Pharaoh's daughter and Pharaoh in Egypt. I want to identify with God's people. First word, identification, or identify. First word is identity. Put that word identity up there. That's the first word. Until you come to a place of realizing who you are, let me say it again. Until you come to a place of realizing who you really are, wait a minute, there will be no direction, there will be no purpose, there will be no value in your life, because you can't do anything until you find out who you are. And I found out that most people that call themselves Christians don't mind admitting they're Christians in church, but live a double life outside of the walls because they're afraid to identify as a Christian. They're afraid in their job. They're afraid on the freeway. They're afraid to wear the shirt. They're afraid to carry their Bible. They're afraid to take their Bible into the restaurant. They're afraid of people, and they're afraid to identify. And until you get to the place where you're past who you are and you know who you are, and that just settles it no matter what the world has to say, there will never be anything that you need to have. I'm going to make this statement to you. It's very important. And it's a great statement if I can share it with you. It's really this important. With identity comes real directions for life. Because without identity, there's no real directions for life. You're just floating around hoping something fits. And a lot of you have been that way because you haven't yet identified who in the heck you are in Christ Jesus. Let me give you an illustration of that, if I may. When I was a young man, I was 22 years old, I was vice president of an insurance company in Southern California. My office was on Wilshire Boulevard, Beverly Hills. I liked it, 22 years old. I was kind of into that stuff. I thought I was a big shot and all that. A guy that worked for me came into my office one day, and I liked him. He was a really nice guy. He used to be a TWA, I don't know if you remember that, he was an airlines, TWA pilot. And he gave that up to come to work for the organization, the insurance company. He came into my office one day and he said to me, he sat down, I said, what can I do for you? He said, listen, hey, I got to talk to you about something just the way it is. I was in church last night and I got saved. I said, oh, that's great. He says, no, I'm here to talk to you about you. You need to get saved. I said, I don't know what you're talking about. He says, well, you need to be born again, the Bible says, and you need to get saved. And of course, being full of pride and a young man in that position, I said, look, I have a really good relationship with God. I don't know what you're talking about. I've been part of this so-and-so denomination, said so as a kid. Of course, I hadn't gone to church in years. I was too into myself to go to church. You know what I'm talking about? And so I said, oh, you know, just forget that. He says, no, you need to invite Jesus into your heart and ask him to be your Lord and Savior, become born again. And I went, oh man, this guy's really irritating me. Eventually he got up and he left my office, and I thought, geez, what a jerk, you know? But his words absolutely tormented me. Does anybody ever know what that's like? You kind of like hear them over and over and over. At night you go to sleep, you don't remember anything else. You just hear the words of this guy, you need to be born. I am telling you, it was like driving me nuts for like 3 days. And finally I stopped my car, I remember exactly where it was. I bowed my head and I said, God, I don't know what it is I'm doing, but I'm asking you, Jesus, to be my Lord and Savior. Come into my heart. I want to be born again. I want you to come now as my Savior into my heart. And I just lifted my head and I just knew something was different on the inside of me. I knew God had come into my life. And it was like so cool. But I made this statement to myself, I'm not going to tell him because, you know, I'm full of pride. I'm going to go back to work the next day, but I'm not telling him I have nothing to do. First thing I did when I saw him is I said, hey, I got to talk to you. I said, hey, man, I want you to know I prayed and I asked Jesus to come be my Lord and Savior. I think I'm born again, and man, I really feel different. He said, that's so great. He says, I'll buy you lunch today. I said, okay, I'm thinking free lunch from the dope. Okay, I'm gonna, you know, free lunch, great. He says, come on, lunchtime comes, so we go down the street. We're walking down the street to a Jewish delicatessen. I'll never forget it. My favorite food in the whole world is from a Jewish delicatessen. I mean, I love the, like a Reuben sandwich, you know. It's, oh, aren't you, anybody getting hungry right now? And the wonderful, you know, cabbage soup and that pickle. Oh, my goodness. I don't need to eat anything else for the rest of my life except that. I love Jewish delicatessen. So it takes me to Jewish delicatessen, but it's different. Jewish delicatessen is really Jewish. And it's filled with people, just packed. And, you know, in our society, we go to a restaurant. You know, we go over to a restaurant, so-and-so. You got one table for two or table for four, and they get you a table, and four of you sit down together on the table, or two of you sit together at the table. In those days, on Beverly Hills, in a Jewish community, there were more people in the restaurant than they had seats for. So they have a seat, so 8-10 people around the table, And 8 people might be around the table. You don't know, but if there's 2 seats, you get someone to move over, you can sit next to your friend. And I'm sitting at this table with like 8-10 people. I'm thinking nothing. Woman comes over. I order. I say, you know, give us this. And he orders, you know. And I say, oh, it's great. The food comes. I'm thinking this is great. And the guy says to me, let's pray. I'm going, wait a minute, man. Wait a minute. Okay, yeah, I'm thinking he's going to just like whisper a little, you know, God bless this food. He grabs a hold of my hand, lifts it up in some Pentecostal experience. Listen to this. And he yells, Jesus! I'm thinking, oh my God, we're in a Jewish delicatessen. Thank you, Jesus, the sinner got saved. And Lord, thank you for bringing him into the kingdom of God. And the place goes absolutely dead quiet. Everybody stopped chewing. They're all staring at it. You can hear a pin drop in the place. And he goes on and on and on. And my hand's up in the air. And the sweat is like pouring off of me. I'm soaked through all of my clothes. Finally, he says, amen. I said, oh, yeah. My point being is I did not want to be identified. I hated the identity. It was embarrassing. And nothing ever happened in my life until I recognized who I was and stopped being afraid of who I was. It's at that time things started happening. Now, I made a statement to you. Along with, if you remember the statement, we just put it up, identity comes real direction for life. Remember that? I want to show it to you in Scripture. I want you to turn with me, if you will, into Luke, the 5th chapter. We're going to look at a couple of verses in Luke, the 5th chapter. Let me tell you the story so I don't have to read a lot of verses. This is the time when a guy by the name of Simon is fishing. The real name of Simon is Peter. You know him better as Peter. And Simon and his brothers are out fishing, and his partners in the fishing business are out fishing. And when they fish on the Sea of Galilee, they catch this little fish that's about this big. And it is awful. I have eaten the fish, so has Deborah. We ordered it. We thought it's got to be wonderful. It's like the worst fish I ever ate in my life. It tastes like something that's been in the trash can for a month. But they love this fish there. They just think it's the coolest fish in the whole world. And they catch this fish. And Simon had been fishing all night long, because you don't catch this fish except at night. And he's back now in the morning, and he's washed all of his nets. And Jesus comes by and looks at Simon and says, Simon, I want to use your boat. I'm going to push out a little from the shore, and I'm going to teach all these people that are following me. And Simon says, okay. So he gets in the boat, and he pushes out from shore. He teaches the people. Then Jesus makes a statement to Simon. And he says, Simon, I want you to let down your nets and fish. You're going to catch a lot of fish. Now, I know what's running through Simon's mind, because I know Peter. Peter's like you and me. First thing, he's probably thinking, wait a minute, you gotta be kidding me. I'm a fisherman and a pro and caught nothing all night long. You're a carpenter, if I'm not mistaken. You don't know nothing about fishing. But then he looks at Jesus and he says, hey, but at your word, I'll let down the net. And he lets down the net, and you know the story. He fills it up so much, he fills up the boat. He has to call his partners and brothers and everybody to come and help haul all the fish in. It's a great miracle. And remember, we're talking about his identity. We're talking about this guy by the name of Simon who's going to become Peter. But listen to what Jesus says to Simon, if you will, in the 10th verse. Let's just pop it up, of the 5th chapter of Luke. And also who were with him, it was James and John, son of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. And Jesus says to Simon, do not be afraid. Now watch the identity change right here. You are now on, from now on, you will catch men. From now on, you will catch men. In other words, his entire life has just changed because of identity that gives him direction. Now, when he has this identity, he's a fisher of men. Verse 11, here's now has direction. And when they had brought their boats to land, they forsook all and followed him. Guys, without identity, there's no direction. And without direction, there's only gonna flounder around, never doing the right thing, never getting blessed as God wants to bless you, never walking in the prosperity that God has for you, or in the reality that God wants you to live. Everything doesn't happen until identity takes place. First word, everybody say it, identity. Let's try it again. First word, what? Identity. Let's take a look back, if you will. In fact, before I take you back to Hebrews, the 11th chapter, could I talk about identity just for a second more? Because I thought it was kind of fun to look at the life of Paul. Notice what Paul writes in Galatians, the 2nd chapter, verse number 20. In the 2nd chapter, verse 20, pop it up for us. I have been crucified. Listen to the identity and listen to the direction that he has. I have been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who lives, but Christ lives in me. And the life in which I now, look at the direction, which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith. Totally different since he changed his identity and related with God. See, what you don't understand is God identifies with you all the time. And we're afraid to identify with him. When Paul was persecuting the church, Jesus said to Paul, why do you persecute me? He said, who are you? He said, I am Jesus. Well, Paul says, I'm not persecuting you, Jesus. I'm persecuting your followers. But Jesus so identified with the followers, when they were persecuted, he was persecuted. And we're so afraid not to identify with God. He says these, I live by the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. His identity completely changed. He was no longer afraid to be a Christian even publicly. Is anybody listening? Now, with that in mind, go with me to Hebrews, the 11th chapter, because the first word was what? Identity. Now, Hebrews 11 chapter, this time, if you will, and it's a wonderful verse, in verse number 25. In verse 25 of Hebrews 11 chapter, let me read it to you, and then I'm going to give you the second word. Now, look at this. Hebrews 11 chapter, verse 25. Choosing rather to suffer the afflictions with the people of God than to enjoy the passing pleasure of sin. Oh, my goodness. You got to be out of your mind to make that kind of a choice. Choosing rather to suffer affliction than the pleasures of Egypt. Do you know what the pleasures of Egypt are? The best wine, the best food, the best lamb, servants waiting on you, the best rooms, the most comfortable it could possibly be, everything you could ever possibly want, nothing. He makes this kind of a choice. He chooses God over the stuff of this world. Fascinating. The second word that you need to write down is the word choices. A person is defined by their choices. Without choices, you'll never do anything. Right choices take you to blessings. Wrong choices take you to death. Let me say it again. The Bible says, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. You can always tell where a person's at, whether they're in business or family, whatever. It's whatever comes out of their a consistent basis, whatever comes out of their mouth. But listen to this. It's not just the words that come out of the mouth. It's the lifestyle. The lifestyle is seen by what's in their heart. What's in their heart is recognized, listen to this, you want to be wise, by their choices. When you see somebody making choices that are godly, they get prosperous. You see someone making choices that are not godly, you'll see failure. And oftentimes, we don't understand this very principle of choices works for the negative as well as for the positive. Because you've known people that call themselves Christians that have failed. Why? Bad choices. Why? Did God fail? No. They failed making wrong choices. In fact, let me take you to Deuteronomy, Old Testament. God's the same yesterday, today, and forever. In Deuteronomy 30th chapter, it's kind of fun, verse number 19. Deuteronomy 30th chapter, verse 19 says it like this. I call the heaven as witness. In other words, here's God saying, listen, I want you to know all of heaven and earth is listening to what I'm saying. This is like the gavel has come down and the judge has spoken. And he says these words, I have called the heaven and earth as a witness today against you that I have set before you. Oh, wait a minute. I have set before you. Some of you didn't get it. I have set before you. In other words, God has put something before us. Life or death. Listen to these words. Blessing or cursing. What your life is today is because of choices you're making. Whether blessed or cursed. It's about choices you make. Is anybody listening? Because without understanding that principle, God says these words, therefore, notice this word, therefore, because I set before you life or death, blessings or cursing, it's your option. Therefore, choose. I mean, God tells you, choose something? No, choose life. Where does life come from? But from God. See, when I find out how to choose life, is finding out what God says about life and doing it. And then applying it in my life. Whatever it might possibly be, if it's fear, you know, I'm gonna apply the right principle to that so that I don't live in fear. Whether it's anxiety, I'm gonna apply the right principles for anxiety. Whether it's marital relationship, how do I do this? I apply the right thing. So I have before me, set before life, death, cursing, or blessing, the choice is mine. Isn't that interesting? You always thought the choice was God's. The choice for your future is yours. And a lot of people don't understand it's all about what you choose. So you can identify with God, choose the right thing, and according to this, get blessed. Or you could identify with the world, be afraid of who sees you as a Christian, and really back off of that and choose the wrong thing and be cursed. And it's your call, not mine, and even not even God's. Now, well, let me just share this with you. It's kind of fun. I like this part. Choose life that both you and your descent, I mean, God doesn't just bless you. He blesses your kids' kids. Because you walk in the ways of the Lord, your kids' kids will be blessed. Oh, my goodness, the descendants, notice the S on the end of the word descendants, may what? Live. All because you choose life. How do you choose life? By applying what's truth from the word of the Lord. Is anybody listening? And that's called choices. It's such a cool verse, but let me just show it to you in a little different light. You're already there in Deuteronomy, the 30th chapter. Let's go back, if you will. I think it's a 9th verse. Let's take a look at Deuteronomy, the 9th verse. The Lord your God will make you bound in all of your work of your hand, in the fruit of your body, in the increase of your livestock, and the produce of your land for good. You say, well, I'm not a farmer. I don't have any livestock. He's talking about your business. God wants to prosper your choices so that you're blessed. Let's go to the B part of that. For the Lord will again rejoice over you for good as he rejoices over your fathers. I thought that was good, but I loved the next verse talking about choices. If the biggest little word and probably one of the most important words in the Bible is two letters. If means you can do it or not do it. It's your call. If God would never tell you to do something you can't do. If you obey the voice of the Lord, man, that's a choice. Your God. And keep his commandments and his statutes, which are written in this book of the law, verse B part. Listen to this. If you turn, here's another choice. Is that not a choice, turning? If you turn to the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, that means identity, my friend. And all of a sudden, here's the way to get blessed. And so many times we don't realize this. First thing happens is our identity has got to change. In order for us to come along and make these wonderful choices that are going to lead us somewhere, which is to the third word. The first one being, what was it? Identity. The second one being, what? Choices. But I like the third word because it really says a lot. It's found, if you will, in verse number 26. Let's go back to Hebrews 11 chapter, verse number 26. Anybody listening this morning? In Hebrews 11 chapter, verse number 26. And it says this, esteem, talking about Moses, here's what he was thinking, here's what he was feeling, here's what he put an importance on. Esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures of Egypt. You gotta be kidding me. He saw the value, that's your third word, of the reproach of Christ better than the material stuff that Egypt had to offer. In other words, he placed such a value on the things of God that the things of the earth didn't matter. Didn't mean that God didn't want you to have them. Didn't mean that God didn't want you to keep them. Didn't mean God didn't want to bless you with them. We just saw that God wants to bless you with all of those things. But guess what? He wants you to place a value above the things of this world. And the word value is so important that we don't realize how important it is. Can I just say something? Everything in your life rotates around the word value. Husband came in to me not too long ago and sat down for counsel, and he says, you know, I just don't think much of my wife anymore. I'm not in love with her anymore. I said, were you in love with her when you married her? He says, oh yeah, man, we had a great time. We really loved each other. What happened? He said, I don't know. We just kind of like drifted apart. I said, here's what happened. You lost your value. You treat her as common, and what you treat as common will become common. But if you place it as a value and keep it as value, then all of a sudden it becomes valuable. It's in the value that you protect and you fight for. If I had a watch, which I don't have, I'm just going to use this as an illustration, and it was gold and had diamonds, it was worth tens of thousands of dollars. Lots, believe it or not, San Bernardino, there's people out there with watches on that are worth more than your house. And someone gave it to you, you would say, oh, this is valuable. And you'd place it in a safe place. You'd make sure that nobody gets to it. You'd protect it because it was valuable to you. What's valuable to you, you will fight for. What's valuable to you, you will protect. What valuable to you, you will go after. What value to you, you will want always. But what you treat as common will become common. And something that starts out as valuable can become very common to us because we don't put an emphasis on it. Now, here's what the Bible says. The Bible says, where your treasure is, that's where your heart is. And when your treasure is not in the things of God, you don't have a value for God. All of a sudden, other things become more valuable. It's like a young guy buying an automobile for the first time. You ever seen that? Man, he's got this automobile, and it's the coolest thing in the world to him. You wouldn't even drive it, but he thinks it's great. He's out there washing it, he's scrubbing it, he's polishing it, he's getting it all together, he's painting the wheels, he's got a little sound on it so it sounds like it's farting when it goes down the freeway. You know what I'm talking about, San Bernardino. Hate those little cars. You know what I'm talking about. He's really into this. 8 months later, he doesn't wash it. Why? Because he started treating it as common instead of always seeing it as valuable. I've seen my Debbie as valuable from the day I married her. To this day, she's more valuable than she was when I married her. Because that's the way we're supposed to. But you know what most people do? They miss the value of the Word of God. They all of a sudden come to church for a while and say, wow, that's really good, that's really great. And then it starts to get, oh, we're going to church again. And all of a sudden the emphasis is off the value of the importance of hearing the Word of God and being encouraged by some preacher and the Word of God coming forth and learning and growing so that you can be all that God's called you to be and do all that God's called you to do. Instead of that, we lose our value with the things of God. Because where our treasure is where our heart's at. And we put our treasure in everything else, but in the things of God. But Moses didn't do that. Now here's a formula that you got to see, and God gives it to us out of Matthew, the 13th chapter. I'll just put it on the overhead for you. Matthew, the 13th chapter. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field. Oh my God. Oh my God. Can you imagine walking in a field and you're stumbled over a corner of a something. You start to move the dirt away, and it's a square metal box. And you move the dirt away even more, and you kind of get your fingers underneath it, and you start to dig it out. You say, what's this metal box doing in this field? And you open up the metal box. Somehow it just pry it open. And it's full of gold, silver, and diamonds, rubies, and gems. And you went, oh my goodness. And you slammed it closed because you didn't want anybody to see it. And you dug the hole a little deeper and you put it over and you covered it up. But you remember where it was. And you looked up and there's a for sale sign on the property. It said for sale. But you couldn't afford it. But you know the metal box is there. So you run home and you sell everything you have to get that metal box. That's what he says here. The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and hid. And for the joy over it, he goes and sells all that he has and buys the field. Why? Because of value. What we do is we forget this all the time. We forget the valuable things in our life that have changed our life from the things of God. Let me show you what you learned today. There's three words. You remember what they were? Number one was what? Identity. Number two was what? Choices. And number three was what? Values. What is that all and how does it work? Hidden mysteries of God. Are you ready? Let's pop it up for you. Here it is. Let's just take a look. Identity brings choices. Choices brings value. It's that simple. Here's the warning. It works for the negative as well as the positive. Almost everything in God's word works for the negative as well as the positive. Here's why. What you sow, you reap. You sow nothing, you get nothing. You sow something, you get something. You sow bad, you get bad. You sow God, you get God. And if you sow identity that's in something else other than Jesus Christ, then you'll make choices that are wrong choices that take you to things that are valueless in your life. And they become a burden on your life and you wonder why God isn't in it. Or you can take identity in Christ that's more important than anything the world has to offer. Make choices based on what he has to say that'll bring you to the values because God has set before you life, death, blessings, and cursing. And my friends, it's your choice, no one else. All you have to do, how simple it is to level out the playing field with God is choose him for everything. So we started off saying the Word of God is the hidden mysteries. If you find them, you found a great treasure. If you apply them, you have great value and you will be blessed. If God spoke to you today, come on, be honest, then give him a praise. Will you do that? Wonderful. Three little verses out of the Bible, but it started with a verse they saw into the spirit realm. You have to today see into the spirit realm what God's saying and then start applying it. Man, that's good word. Come on, somebody. Give the Lord one more great big praise. Will you do that? He's worthy. Now, here's what I want to talk to you about. All of you that are getting up and leaving, that is like totally unacceptable. And it is, can I just say this to you? It is plain bad church etiquette. So let's talk about church etiquette. I don't expect any of you to stop, but I have speakers all the way to your car, so you're going to hear me all the way. Bad church etiquette is coming to church and leaving right after the message is preached. And the reason for that, especially in our church, is because this is an opportunity for a lot of people to get right with God before you leave. Really get right with God. And when you get up and leave, what you do is you take people with you. And when you take people with you, other people see you get up and leave. And you know, the Bible calls us sheep. So when one leaves, another one will get up, and another one will get up, and another one will get up. We've had 200-300 people in one service get up and leave. Like crazy. So I'm asking you to remain seated. I'm asking you because I love you. I'm asking you because I care about the souls of people that you will pull out from this place that need to get right from God. So think of somebody else besides yourself and stay seated for the next few minutes. Is that okay? And I'll let you go in just a few minutes. Here's what I want to talk to you about. I want to ask you two questions. The first question you answer to yourself, nobody will know but you and God. The second question, answer it, nobody will know but you and God. But I want to ask you these two questions because I want you to check yourself out to make sure that you're okay with God before you leave. Is that all right? Very important. You know, the Bible says that you should check yourself out from time to time to make sure you're okay with God. So this is a very godly thing to do. Here's the first question. If you were to walk out of this building, head towards your car, and your heart stopped and you died, bang! Would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? Don't give me this I don't believe in hell stuff. Doesn't mean you're not going to go there. It doesn't go away because you don't believe in it. God speaks about it numerous times, Old Testament, New Testament. There is a hell whether you want to acknowledge it or not. And if you don't acknowledge it, you might end up there. So let's just stop playing games. Answer the question. If you died, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? Now, your answer says a lot about where you're really at. Remember, nobody knows what you answered. So let's talk about some of your answers today. Some of you said, I think that if I died, I would go to heaven. I think I'd make it. Can I tell you something? Nowhere in the Bible does it say you get to think your way into heaven, like whoever's the most positive thinker gets to go to heaven. You're not going to make it. And somebody needs to tell you. Somebody might say this, and your answer was this. I hope that if I died, I hope I'd go. Can I tell you something? Nowhere in the Bible does it say you get to hope your way into heaven. Like whoever's the greatest, I don't even know if this is a word, hoper, you get to go to heaven. You're not going to make it. Somebody needs to tell you. Some of you might have answered and said, you don't understand, Pastor Jim. My mom and dad told me I was a Christian when I was a kid. I always thought of myself a Christian. They took me to catechism or Sunday school or Sabbath school class, put a cross or a St. Christopher around my neck. Man, I've always thought of myself as a Christian. Can I tell you something? Nowhere in the Bible does it say you can think of yourself as a Christian and your mom and dad told you a Christian makes you a Christian because they put some religious jewelry around your neck. You're not a Christian, and somebody needs to tell you that's not how you get to heaven. Jesus said, watch this. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Now watch what he says. No man goes to the Father except by me. You can't get there your way. You can't get there my way. You can't get there some well-meaning church committee's way. Not going to work. You're going to have to get there his way. Now listen closely. He comes to a guy by the name of Nicodemus, John 3rd chapter, and tells us how to get to heaven. Oh my goodness. Nicodemus, what a funny name. You know, Nicodemus is an example, again in the scripture, for us to learn for us what to do. So this guy Nicodemus is really a peculiar person. Did you know that Nicodemus was the head of his church, the synagogue? Did you know he's really a spiritual man? Did you know he quoted scripture, debated scripture? Listen to this, preached the scripture, and listen to this, sang the scripture? Did you know that Nicodemus was a guy that fed the poor? And he comes to Jesus, he says, Jesus, how does a man get to heaven? I would have thought, wouldn't you, that Jesus would have patted him on the back and said, good job, Nicodemus, you're gonna love heaven when you get there, and they're waiting for you, don't worry about it, you made it. Because of all the good things he did. No, he doesn't do that at all. My friends, listen to what Jesus says. He looks at Nicodemus, even though he did all those great things, even more than what we do, and he says these words of him, you must be born again. Now, I know when I use those words, born again, Americans turn off all over the planet because Hollywood movies, television, and all that stuff has brainwashed us to think that born-again people are idiots, fools, and radicals, but that's not what it's about. That's not what Jesus was talking about. You know, a lot of times people go to church, they really don't know what born-again means, and I want you to know. So I'm going to tell you what born-again means from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible. Here's what born-again means. It means you've given God. You've given God. You've given God all of your heart and all of your life. Did you know it's an all or nothing relationship with Jesus Christ? God forgive us in American churches for 250 years. We've watered that down. It's all or nothing. It's always been all or nothing. I'll prove it to you by the scripture. Last book in the Bible, you've heard of it, the book of Revelation. Jesus is speaking. He says, I'm coming again, and when I come, I better find you hot or I better find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I'm going to vomit you from my mouth. Oh my goodness. I thought Jesus just said nice, sweet things all the time. Man, can I use a term in San Bernardino? He is up in your face about that. I'm going to vomit you from my mouth. Who? People that are lukewarm. Let's define for you what lukewarm is. Check it out. Lukewarm, little in, little out. Little up, little down, lukewarm, token prayer, occasional church attendance, lukewarm. You're not against God. Oh, no. But you're not wholehearted for God. God is just something in your life. He's not everything. Oh, my goodness, that's lukewarm. And you're going to get vomited from the mouth of Jesus. You say, well, Pastor Jim, how do I get right with God? You got to do it God's way, remember? Jesus tells us these words. He says, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you as mine before my Father. But if you deny me, I'll deny you. You know, you can sit there like this and get just turned off the old man in front of you right now. I'm not going to do it. Not going to do it. Pure pride. Or you can get right with God today because you know you need to give him all of your heart, give him all of your life. Did you know he lets you make the choice? That's what we're talking about. To identify with him so your life can have value. Oh, isn't that wonderful? Have you heard those words before? Your choice today. Sit there and do nothing or get right with God. Jesus said, if you confess me before men, I'm a man. Can I just talk to you for a moment? Let's be honest with each other. Everybody in here, look at me for a second. I already know that you know who Jesus is. You know that. That will not get you to heaven because you celebrate Christmas and celebrate Easter. It will not get you to heaven. Somebody needs to love you enough to tell you the truth. Here's why I know that. The devil knows who Jesus is, and he's not going to heaven. It's not what you have in your head. Listen. Look at me. It's not what you have in your head. It's what you've done with your heart. Have you given him all of your heart and given him all of your life? And only you can do it. Nobody can make you do it. I can't make you do it. I can just present to you the truth. You have to make the choice by identifying with him to get the values that are waiting for you. It's your call. You're cool. In a moment, I'm going to count to three. I'm going to go like this. And then I want you to raise your hand. You say, wait a minute. You're going to go like what? One, two, three. I'll go, bang. Your hand goes up. I'll see your hand go up. You say, wait a minute. I can't raise my hand. I'll be embarrassed. Yep, you will be. Get over it. It's better to be embarrassed in a safe place like this than to be in hell forever and ever, because you care more about what people think and see instead of what God sees. Come on, no one's that stupid, but the devil thinks you are, and he's trying to keep you from raising your hand right now. Who should raise her hand if you've been running from God instead of to God? I'm speaking to you. If you've never given him all of your heart, never given him all of your life, you know who you are. I'm speaking to you. If you're one of those people that are in here and you're just not sure, maybe you prayed with Billy Graham, maybe you prayed with a Harvest Crusade, but you never followed through with all of your heart and life. It was just a little magical abracadabra formula of a prayer, but your heart wasn't in it at all. Can I tell you something? Today is your day of salvation. Get ready to put your hand up also. All across this auditorium, wherever you're at, you know you need to give God all of your heart, give God all of your life. I'm going to count three, pop my hands together. I want to see your hand back in the family rooms. They're all packed out. Listen to this. It's time for you to get your hands up also. All across this auditorium, hands are already going up, but hold on, we'll do it all at the same time. Here it is. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. There's one, two, three, four, five. Thank you. Back over here. There's six. Thank you. Back here. There's seven. There's eight. There's nine. Thank you. Back over on this side. Where's your hand? There's 10. There's 11. Thank you. There's 12. There's 13. Thank you. There's 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19. Thank you. Back over here. Where are you? There's another one there. 20. Thank you. God bless you. I didn't embarrass them. 21. I won't embarrass you. 22, 23. Thank you. Back in the family. Put your hands down. I see you all back there. God bless you. 23 already. Is there any more? Any more? There's another one. 24 in that family room. Where are you? 25. Where are you, 25? I'm a greedy little preacher. I love numbers. Where are you, 25? You're pointing over here. So, hey, 25, got you right there. God bless you. Wonderful. Where are you, 26? 26. Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Wave at me because I you're all blending together. Way over this far side. 26, where are you? Oh, back in the family room. I think I might have already got them, didn't I? No? All right, 26. I love numbers. I'll do that. Jump over 27. Where are you, 28? 27 was going to take too long. Where are you, 28? You need to put your hand up. Anybody else real quick? Anybody else? Anybody else? Okay, let's give the Lord a great big praise. Woo! Here's what I need you to do real quick. I want you to get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible friend. All of you that are 27, 28, that raise your hand, I'm speaking to you. And anybody that should have raised their hand, you can come too. Check with your neighbor. Say, come on, I'll go with you. But I want you to get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible friend. Bring your stuff. Get out of the seat. No one leaves during this period of time. I'll let you go in a minute. Promise. But let's get these people. You get in the aisle. Meet me right here in front. You from the family rooms. Grab your stuff. Grab your kids. Come on down here. The ushers will help you. Let's give them a hand as they come.
Jesus, we love you. And oh, how we love you.
Oh, they're coming. They're coming. They're coming.
You are the one.
Oh, they're coming. They're coming. They're coming. They're coming, come on. They're coming. They're coming. Give me a hand as they come. From the foyer, come on.
Jesus, we love you.
From the foyer, come on.
And oh, how we love you. You are the one.
Oh, they're still coming. Give me a hand. They're still
Jesus,
coming. Give them a hand.
Love you. And oh, how we love you.
Woo. Oh, they're still coming. Come on, we'll wait for you. Come on.
Oh, our hearts and oh.
All right, everybody in front, I have an assignment for you. Here's the assignment. Put a smile on your face. This is a good thing. It's not a bad thing. You're not going to hell and you're not going to a morgue. So stop looking like you're in a morgue. Be happy. You're getting saved, going to heaven, having eternal life, and going to get blessed. That's a good thing. Now, real quick, I want you to look over here. See this guy waving at you? His name is Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel's going to do three things. One, he's going to pray with you to invite Jesus in your heart. Second, he's going to give you some free. I love the word free. The F word here is free at this church. And San Bernardino. And so here, free, man. Free stuff. Now that you're saved, in a minute, after you pray, he's going to give you a booklet that tells you what to do next. What does God expect from you? Pretty cool, huh? Secondly, listen to this. He is going to invite you to be part of an organization called Spiritual Personal Trainers. What that means, you come to church, you meet up with somebody who's a friend. A friend. They buy you coffee, tea, nacho, steak, lobster, whatever you want. They'll buy you something, you know? And then you eat and you talk and they give you some scripture that help you get strong. About four or five times, and after four or five times, man, you're ready to tell somebody about Jesus and be strong. Let us help you. You've heard of spiritual, personal trainers in gymnasiums, so you know they work really hard and they make you buff like me. Oh, shut up. And so this is spiritual personal trainers. Is that okay? Only takes a few minutes. The people you came with, they'll wait for you. Make a left turn. Follow Pastor Joel right over this way. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise. Woo!